Hello everyone, in this lecture we are going to look into the types of road intersections. Now I am very sure that all of you must have seen road intersection, what we call in Marathi, if you say a chauk. Okay, so you have seen that intersection, but now I will be just throwing on some light on some technical terms or technical names, you can say, about these road intersections. So first of all, if we classify broadly, so you can have two types of road intersections. One is at grade and second is grade separated. Now those who have stayed in PCMC for a long time, so you must have seen this type of intersection as well, the grade separated. And others also might have seen this, but you might have not known that, okay, this is known as a grade separated intersection. So we'll look into that in this lecture. The main difference between at grade and grade separated is that at grade, as in the regular intersection that you have on any type of any road, okay, means two roads are meeting each other at 90 degree or at some angle, or one road is meeting another road. So that type of intersection, in basically all the roads, whatever are the number of roads, it may be two roads intersecting each other, 3, 4, 5, 6. In at grade intersection, all the roads, they are at the same level. Okay, as in there is no difference in the elevation of all the roads. More or less, they are at same level, or they meet at a same level. That is nothing but at grade intersection. And grade separated is the opposite of that. Opposite of at grade, that is, whatever is the number of roads which are intersecting each other in grade separated intersection, they are going to intersect, but not physically intersect. The intersection point is going to be at different levels. So you'll come to know very clearly when you see the photographs. So definitions or the theory I have written here, that all roads meet at the same level in at grade intersection, and then in case of intersecting road in grade separator, the intersecting roads are separated by difference in level. So we'll see, look into it through photographs. You'll come to know what is a grade separated and what is a at grade intersection. So this is the basic difference. So on the left, top left, what you see, this is a typical example of a at grade intersection. So this is what I was talking about. It is an intersection in Pune city. So you have one road over here, and you have another road over here, and both the roads are intersecting each other, and basically both the roads are at the same level. Okay. Same level as in elevation difference is not there. Okay. This road continues and goes over here, so it's a sort of a four-legged intersection. And on the right side, bottom right, if you see, this is a typical photograph of a grade separated intersection. So this is what I was saying about. Okay. That the intersecting point in this at grade, whatever this intersecting point was there, so that intersecting point is over here, but it's a virtual one. There is no physical intersection, as in the road going in this direction, it is at the topmost level. Then below that you have number of roads which are going in some other direction, taking some turn or diversion. Okay, so this is nothing but a grade separated intersection. So even two flyovers over each other, they are also a grade separated intersection. Okay. So the ones living in PCMC who have been to Nashik Fata, so there you have a two, it is said that it's a double decker flyover. So it's not a double decker flyover, technical term is not that, it's a grade separated intersection. So one road is going from top and another road is going from below, so that's a grade separated. Even the grade separators which are there in PCMC, those are also grade separated intersection, because a straight going road goes below through the vehicle underpass, and from top you have another road which goes crossing it. Okay, so those are nothing but grade separated intersections. Now you have different forms of these intersections, and these forms basically they are termed, or the name is coined in view of what shape it makes. Okay, basically, so if you see in this slide, so the forms of intersection, we have a T intersection. Again, it from the shape itself you will come to know that two roads intersecting, they form a T shape. So that's why a T intersection Then likewise, you have cross, you have staggered, you have skewed cross, skewed stagger, a Y intersection, and a multiple intersection. So I have tried to show photographs for each of it. So if you see here, top left, the photo number one, so that's a typical T intersection. So you have one road over here, and you have second road over here, and it is forming a T over here. Okay, so it's a T intersection. Then top right, it's a cross intersection, as in you have two roads and they are crossing each other at 90 degree. So it's a cross intersection. Bottom left, you will see a staggered intersection. Now staggered, it is you have a road, main road, and then you have two roads which are there at a very short distance. So the distance between this two roads, it's not quite large, it is a short one, but they are not intersecting, or there is a difference between the cross intersection and staggered, as in the roads, two roads which will be meeting the main road, so they will not be meeting the main road at a single point, they will meet the main road at two different locations. So generally the staggered intersection is preferred, where you have to decongest that area. And you all know that at an intersection you have number of movements. We have seen in the conflict point diagram that if you give a intersection, a four leg intersection, then if you have all type of movements over there, or three kinds of movements for a single road, and if you have four roads, so there are a lot of conflict points over there. So to avoid that and to decongest that intersection, what is done is this staggered intersection is adopted. Okay, so the two small roads, they will be connected to the main road, but not at a single point, but at some different points. Okay, but the distance is not too long. So this staggered intersection, what you see on the bottom left, okay, so this kind of intersection you can see if you have visited to Delhi, and if you go from Delhi Aerocity metro station to the actual airport, so while going you will come to know that you have to take a turn to that Delhi airport, but you have to travel some distance and then take a U-turn and then go to the road which goes to the Delhi airport. So that kind of intersection is staggered one. On the bottom right also, what photo you see, that is also a sort of a staggered, but now the distance, if you see, the exact point of meeting is not the same. Here the roads are meeting in such a way. Okay, so it's a closely spaced stagger. Okay, here the distance is maybe even tens or a 10 meter or so, for example, and here it's a bit more, it may be a 100 meter or so. Okay, 50 to 100 meter. So that is your staggered intersection. Basically staggered intersection, they are useful when you have to keep the vehicles moving, you don't want a queue formation. So their staggered intersection, and that too in staggering of 100 meter or so, it is useful. It's also, staggered intersection is seen at many locations where you have urban roads or urban area, and you have to decongest it and avoid the queue. So in Mumbai also, a lot of traffic signals have this staggered intersection kind of arrangement. Then you have a skewed intersection, top left. So just the main road and the minor road, they are meeting each other, but at some angle, it's not 90 degrees. So that's a skewed intersection. Then you have a skewed cross, again the same way, that the two roads, or four roads you can say, they are intersecting each other, but not at 90 degree. So in cross intersection, you had the roads meeting at 90 degree, but in skewed cross, it's not at 90 degree, at some different angle. Then you have a Y intersection. From the name itself, you'll get that it makes a Y shape. Okay. It's sort of a diverging road, that one road diverges into two road. So that is a Y intersection, you can say. And then you have a multiple road intersection. Now this also you can see in lot of cities. The photo that you see over here, it is a photo of Pune city. The intersection at Alka Talkies, or the Lakdi Bridge intersection, that is said in the common language in Pune. So it is this intersection where you have a ad grade intersection and you have five roads, I guess, five roads which are meeting each other at this particular intersection. So more than two or three or four roads, it goes into a multiple road intersection. Even the Chandni Chowk intersection in Pune, it is sort of a multiple road, but now they have separated the levels. Okay, the one road goes from top, one road goes from below. But previously, before the development of that Chandni Chowk, it was a multiple road intersection where all the roads were meeting at the same level. Okay, before even the construction of bypass highway. Then in the next category of intersections, you have unchannelized. Now you have seen in traffic control devices that what is a channelizing island. Basically, it's a land which is, or a bit of elevation is given to a piece of land so that your traffic, it is channelized in a proper way. Okay. So if you have channelizing islands, it's known as channelized intersection. If not, it is known as unchannelized. So that's the thing over here. Again, in that you have the same types, that is T intersection, cross intersection, skew intersection. But now here, if you see, you have one more term which is known as flared intersection. So now what is this flared? So you must have observed a lot of times in some peculiar highways, it is seen that suppose so this hashed portion is the median, and suppose traffic is going in this direction. So this is the direction of traffic, and if there is a median opening, as in someone has to take a U-turn or someone has to take a left turn, so for such vehicles, instead of accommodating them on the two lanes which are predominantly which will be used by the traffic going in straight direction, so a small auxiliary lane kind of thing is prepared just before the turning. Okay. So if this is the intersection over here, if I draw a small part of it, okay, something like this, so the vehicles which are going to turn, either right turn or U-turn, so they can occupy this third lane, which is sort of an auxiliary lane. It's not continuous, but it only appears just before the median. So this kind of arrangement is called flaring or a flared intersection. Okay. So this is also a good way of maintaining or decongesting your intersection, that if you know that a lot of vehicles are going to opt for the straight path and only a few vehicles are going to opt for turning U-turn or right turn, then you can give an auxiliary lane for them so that they don't accumulate over here. And if they accumulate over here, then the vehicles going straight, they are going to face some issues and disturbance over here, and there will be a queue formation. So to avoid that, you don't let them stand over here, you make them stand on this auxiliary lane, and whenever they get a chance, they will go and merge into the mainstream. Okay, so that is nothing but flaring. So that flaring can be at a T intersection, at a cross intersection, it can be anywhere. The point for flaring you have to understand is you should be very well aware of the traffic flow. Okay, so how many number of vehicles are going straight, how many number of vehicles want to take a right turn, how many want to take a U-turn. So based on these values, we'll decide whether to give a flaring or not. Okay, so there your traffic survey comes into picture. And then you have channelized intersection. Now, as I told you, if you have channelizing islands at your intersection, so it's known as channelized. If not, it's unchannelized. So it's one and the same. This unchannelized and channelized, only difference is you have such channelizing islands in this category. Okay. So you have already studied what is channelizing island. You can just go back to the video and check it out when we had discussed the traffic control devices, and basically we had discussed the channelizing islands. Okay, so you can go back to that video and you can see what's a channelizing island. So these are the channelizing islands, and if I use them in an intersection, it is known as a channelized intersection. And then if we come to a rotary intersection, now rotary intersection, or basic, you may call it a circle. Many of the times in layman's term, one calls it a circle. Okay. So that circle is nothing but a rotary island, and in that also you have different shapes. So mostly you must have seen this circular type of rotary island, in which the central island, what you have over here, it's a proper circle. You might have also seen some intersections where you have a elliptical kind of a central island. So this you must have seen near the college, PCCA college, or the Dharmaraj Chowk that you have. So there, whatever the central island was there, now it has been destroyed and rehabilitation is going on, or Shobhikaran is going on for that intersection, Dharmaraj Chowk. So now you don't find it, but earlier it was a elliptical shape, if you would remember that. Then you have a turbine shape, in which the central island is circular, but the roads, if you observe, so they are sort of tangent to this central island. Okay, so that's a turbine kind of arrangement of rotary. And then you have a tangent one, in which the central island is elliptical, and then again the roads are tangent to this ellipse, you can say, more or less tangent, not exact tangent. Okay. The one road is tangent over here, others are tangent over here, and the others are intersecting. So this is the different shapes of a rotary. Then coming towards the grade separated, now till now whatever we had discussed, these intersections, all these intersections were coming under the category of ad grade intersection. So there was no level difference. Now if I have to go for this grade separation, the level difference, so obviously there has to be interchange. Now why this interchange has to be there, that suppose you have a straight going traffic at an intersection, you have a right going traffic, and you also have a left going traffic. Now if we consider Indian scenario, so generally in India this left turning traffic is not an issue, because we have a free left. Okay. But more or less that also has to be considered, and mainly the right turning traffic, that is going to be intersecting with the opposite direction traffic, which is going straight. Okay. So there also you have all these three kind of intersections, or sorry, traffic movements. So basically what is done in grade separated intersection is, whatever are the movements, now here I have shown six traffic movements, so these six traffic movements, they will be separated. Okay, as in the traffic which is going straight, they will be given one level. Okay, the traffic which has to turn left, maybe they will be given a diversion ramp. Okay, the traffic which has to go to the right, so they will also be given a diversion ramp, but maybe an indirect one, something which goes from below these and then it goes to the other side. Okay. Sort of like this. So that is nothing but these, what you see over here, these legs that I have drawn, which are diverging to left and turning right. So these are nothing but interchange ramps. Okay. So the straight moving traffic, we have no issues, we can give a separate level for them, but mainly the turning traffic, you have to give a ramp for them. Okay. So that whatever is the level difference they have to cover, if from the top level they have to come to the ground level, or from ground level they have to go to the upper level, so that can be done using the interchange ramp. And now in interchange ramp, you have different types. Okay. So one can be a direct interchange ramp. Direct as in whatever is the straight going traffic or road, so through that only you remove one branch and then you make them or join them to the another level. So that is a direct kind of a interchange. Then you have a semi-direct one. Semi-direct as in, you can see in this figure also, that instead of directly connecting the road like this, what they have done is they have taken a bit of a curve and then they have joined. Now this mainly depends that whatever is this traffic which is intending to turn right, whether they have to take a U-turn or go to the lower level or go to which direction. So if most of them want to go to left side, so instead of giving direct one, you can give this semi-direct. So those who want to go to the left, they will take a U-turn over here, and those who want to take a right turn, they will go straight. Okay. So in direct, what was happening? Only the right turning traffic was using this direct ramp, but now this semi-direct ramp, it will be used by both the kinds of traffic movements, the ones who have to go to the right and the ones who have to go to the left. So both of them can use the same ramp. So what we are doing is, instead of just increasing the number of ramps and number of levels, because that is also going to cost increase the cost of the project. So instead of giving two ramps for two different movements, I have accommodated both the movements in a single ramp, but the shape is a semi-direct one. Okay. So instead of just joining it like this dotted, I have joined it by taking it to the left and then just merging it with the intersection or with the below level just before the intersecting point. Okay. So this is a semi-direct one. And then you have an indirect one. Now in this indirect, you can see, so whatever is this vehicle which has to take a turn to the right, suppose, so instead of taking a right turn here itself or giving a semi-direct ramp, it crosses the intersecting point, then it comes down and then it merges with the traffic over here. Okay. Now what is the advantage of this, if you ask? So this keeps the flow continuous, as in if you divide it in time frame, so the vehicles which are crossing here from the main road which is below, so they will be interrupted by the merging traffic, right? But this interruption will have some time interval, because the vehicle which is over here, it will take some time to go on this indirect ramp, it will go through that curve and then it will join. So by that time, suppose that is vehicle number one which is merging with the traffic, and then you have vehicle number two over here just behind it, so there will be a time gap between vehicle one and two. Okay. So what I am trying to say is, whatever are the vehicles, if I just use some different colors, just give me a minute. So these red colors indicate the vehicles which are using or which are on this bottom level. Okay. And then you have the merging vehicles which will be using this ramp, interchange ramp, and then they will be merging from this side, say. Let me draw the boundary as well so that you will come to know. So this is the continuous ramp which will go there. So vehicles will come from this ramp down and they will keep on merging over here. So if you give an indirect interchange ramp, so what will happen is, suppose the first vehicle, it merged over here, okay, in this traffic stream, and then the second vehicle, it will take some time to go on this ramp because we have given it in indirect way. So by that time, the main road vehicles, they will get a time to pass on. Okay. So what I am trying to say is, the merging traffic, it is sort of a nuisance to the main road traffic. Okay. So we will say that the red color vehicles, they are the vehicles on the main road, and the blue color vehicles are the vehicles from the ramp which will be merging. So the blue color vehicles are sort of a disturbance, not nuisance, you will not say that. The blue color vehicles are sort of a disturbance to this red color vehicles, but this disturbance, we are just increasing the time gap between the disturbance. Okay. So instead of frequently a blue vehicle popping up and merging it into the traffic stream, as we have given an indirect ramp, there will be some time difference. Okay. Now you will say, obviously, that if there are more number of vehicles on that interchange ramp, so obviously the stream will be continuous. Yeah, that will be true, but again, you will decide whether to give a semi-direct, indirect, or a direct depending on the volume, the traffic volume of the vehicles that you are expecting. So you have to be very sure with the turning movement survey of yours, that how much is the traffic or what is the number of vehicles we are expecting, which will be taking a turn to the right or to the left, and then utilizing this ramp. Okay. So the purpose of interchanging ramp is this, to allow vehicles to go from one level to another. And the perfect utilization of this will be when you have a sufficiently confident data set, which will give you the exact number of, almost exact number of vehicles which will take a turn left or right. Okay, so that is with the interchange ramps. Then you have types of interchanges. So in types of interchanges, now you have a diamond interchange, a partial clover leaf, a full clover leaf, a rotary. Okay, so this is nothing but, if you see here, so diamond interchange, this is the main road over here. Okay, and then you have a bridge. Now that bridge, or the symbol of bridge, is nothing but this road. It is one level below this main road. Okay, and then you have this ramps, interchange ramps, which will let you go from one level to another. So same is the case with all the other interchanges. Now this is the line diagrams, you can see. If I try to show you the actual ones, so this is sort of a diamond interchange. More precise, it's a diverging diamond interchange. Okay, so this is the main road, what you had seen in the line diagram as well. So these are the main roads, and then the another straight moving traffic, it is going from a level below, and then you have these ramps which are going to allow the vehicles to go from one level to another. Okay, so that's a diamond interchange. Then rotary interchange, you know what is a rotary, but now that rotary was a part of grade intersection, at grade intersection, where all the roads were meeting at the same level. Now here you can see you have a rotary below, but all the roads are not meeting at the same level. The main road, which is expected to cater the straight going traffic, it is elevated, or it is at a elevated level, and then the other roads, the turning traffic mainly, they are kept at the lower level. So this is a rotary interchange. Then you have a partial clover leaf. Now in this clover leaf intersections, they are generally the ones which use the indirect method of ramp interchange or interchange ramp. Okay, so they use the indirect interchange ramp. I'll just write the short form. So here you can see the main traffic going left and right, and then the straight going traffic, it is taken from the below level, bottom level, and then you have been provided with this indirect interchange ramps along with some direct interchange ramps as well. Okay, so that's a partial clover leaf. And then you have a full clover leaf. Full clover leaf, it is said that it is the most efficient kind of grade separated interchange, because whatever are the number of movements, suppose there are 12 movements, okay, if you have 4 roads and each road has 3 movements, as we have seen, so if you have total 12 movements, so all these 12 movements are given different levels in a full clover leaf. But as you can see, it covers a very huge area. For example, if you see over here itself, whatever is this area occupied by this clover leaf, and look at the houses which can accommodate in the same area. So that's one disadvantage kind of thing, you can say, or not exactly disadvantage, but sort of a limitation, that if you have a sufficient large area, then only you can go for a full leaf clover leaf, full clover leaf interchange. Okay, so it uses the grade separators, it uses the indirect interchange ramps, it also uses the direct interchange ramps. Okay, so it forms a full clover leaf. So that's all with the types of intersections. We'll stop here for today.